Imagine driving into the heart of Chernobyl, through a landscape of destruction, knowing that the cargo you're hauling could kill you in minutes. This is a story of Chernobyl's dump trucks, machines built for the most dangerous mission on our planet. After the explosion at Chernobyl Unit 4, tons of radioactive debris had to be moved to nearby repository for containment. The debris often emitted over 10 Sieverts per hour, and just a few minutes of exposure to these levels could cause severe radiation sickness. Yet, the job had to be done. Ordinary vehicles weren't enough for this task, so a new kind of machines was needed. One that could withstand lethal radiation levels and keep the driver as safe as possible. A special workgroup of the KRAZ factory in Kremenchuk, here in Ukraine, led by engineer Viktor Kholyavko, took the challenge. Using the KRAZ 256B1 as a base, they had to act fast, and in very short time they created a machine built for the apocalypse. The key feature of this vehicle was the lead-lined sealed capsule that served as the driver's cabin. This capsule wasn't just a simple add-on, it was constructed from specialized panels made of 3mm steel sheets with a layer of lead in between. The floor and side walls of the cabin were lined with 1 inch of lead, and the thickest was the back wall, nearly 2 inch. The windows were made of dark yellow 3 inch anti-radiation glass. It may sound ridiculous, but initially authorities demanded to hide the actual purpose of newly created vehicle. So, designers were forced to try to place this heavy capsule inside a standard cabin. It turned out that yes, it fits, but there is no effective way to accommodate a filter ventilation system for air. So eventually the idea of using any camouflaging was abandoned. But there were more challenges. The weight of this lead-lined capsule added over 3 tons to the truck, and it wasn't evenly distributed. The left side, where the driver sat, was much heavier, so to compensate it, engineers had to reinforce the left side of the frame and adjust the left front spring. Additionally, the pressure in the left front tire was increased, and the wheel was fastened with clamps to prevent any blowouts. To make everything even more reliable, pneumatic and hydropneumatic systems replaced many of the truck's mechanical components. For example, a hydroelectric clutch control drive was installed, and pneumatically controlled energy accumulators were installed on the middle axle. To simplify the traction system, a downshift was constantly engaged, and could be switched off to neutral using an electric pneumatic actuator. The filter ventilation unit was powered by the engine's generator, and in the event of a shutdown it could run on batteries, so 4 of them were installed just in case. By July 10, 1986, the first specialized KRAZ dump truck was ready. Viktor Kholyavko, the lead designer, recalled. The truck left the factory on its own. We couldn't get used to the fact that the cabin was so small with only a single front window. You could see what was going on the sides only through the mirrors, so we installed 2 for the rear view and 2 for the side view, and they were all hemispherical. A strong grumble was unusual. It was the noise of the air being pumped through the filter ventilation unit into the capsule. We drove along the highway through the village of Pishane near Kremenchuk and in the center of the village, turned off the road and drove to its western outskirts where the Chernobyl truck was taken to a meadow overgrown with grass. Well, our doubts about the car's passability dissipated. It moved confidently along the meadow. So we drove with the capsule door closed and maneuvered forward and backward, simulating an approach to an excavator which was represented by a lonely tree. After 1 or 2 trials, we quickly got used to it. Driving the truck didn't cause any problems, even when reversing. We were relying entirely on the mirrors. But that time it was already July, and while they were conducting tests, other solutions were being tried in the zone. For example, makeshift shields were added to regular trucks. Our friend Boris, who works at one of the disposal sites in the zone, however pointed that there were even more unusual machines used. Those were PTS-2 ambitious transporters, which had an extra air filtration system and a thick lead shield installed between the crew's compartment and the cargo hold. Only 2 of these machines were ever used, perhaps because they were too difficult to decontaminate. Surprisingly, both PTS-2 transporters survived and are still at the remains of Rostoka storage site, emitting nearly 1 millisievert per hour as of 2024. But by the end of July 1986, a batch of 7 KRAZ trucks was shipped to the Chernobyl zone and in total 18 were produced. This entire order took the engineers of KRAZ a little more than a month to complete, often working in 2 or even 3 shifts per day. A small but a descriptive side note, a cabin heater was not installed on the truck. That's because at that moment it was assumed that the work to eliminate the consequences of the Chernobyl accident would be completed before the winter cold. Well, that wasn't the case. At the power plant site, these trucks worked in conjunction with Imer and Imer 2 engineering tanks, which loaded radioactive debris into their cargo beds. This operation was precise but dangerous. The debris, some of which came directly from the wreckage of the reactor, was dumped into the KRAZ and transported to the Pidlisny waste repository. The Pidlisny repository is located not so far from the power plant site. It was built quickly with the idea of creating a few simple, overground modules made of a thick concrete blocks with a remote control crane installed later to assist with unloading. This facility is so restricted that you won't find much footage or pictures of it. As it soon turned out, it was so poorly constructed that only 2 of the modules were ever used. Eventually, by 1989, dumping at Pidlisny had stopped entirely, and later additional roofs were built to keep out rainwater. Yet, in 1986, it still did its job. While Pidlisny stands, the fate of these trucks remains a mystery. While some reports suggest that they were buried at the Burakivka disposal site in the depths of the zone, rumors persist of their transfer to the infamous Mayak plutonium facility in Russia, because they're also KRAZ trucks, but if those are the same, they obviously passed modifications, including the addition of a separate seat for a dosimetrist. Anyway, there they were used to help confine another dangerous site called Lake Karachay. That is a liquid radioactive waste dump so deadly that standing nearby for 1 hour could be fatal. Today, these lead armored giants no longer operate in the Chernobyl zone, but the work here continues, and we still need transportation. So once again, the KRAZ factory stepped in to help, and today we can see their modern trucks all over the Chernobyl zone. In our internal slang, we call them the furious KRAZes, and well, to be honest, when one of them appears on the horizon, you'd better keep your distance. And though the levels of contamination nowadays are lower, these trucks are still built to withstand radiation. While there is no need for a capsule anymore, their cargo compartments are made for a special type of steel, designed for easy decontamination, and there is a built-in rollable rubberized cover. Some of these trucks even feature hydraulic-powered lids to prevent any dust from escaping during transportation. Furious KRAZes haul waste to the Burakivka disposal site. Each truck passes over a vacant platform and delivers its content to one of the isolated ditches, where radioactive material is sealed away for the next 300 years. The original Edvine trucks were built for a singular but dangerous mission. And though their work is done now, their story remains a strong example of extraordinary effort that went into managing the aftermath of Chernobyl. The machines of Chernobyl continue to evolve, but their purpose stays the same, to protect us from the dangers hidden behind the zone's barbed wire. We will talk about this in our future episodes. If you made it this far, thank you for watching. Check out our Patreon page where you can find truly unique insights, data and articles about Chernobyl often never translated before. The link is in the description below. This episode is a part of a series, so don't forget to check out our other documentaries. We have many, many interesting things to watch. And see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.